This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. The Family Swap. The bizarrely true story of two Yankee baseball players who decided to trade families. By Frank Foster. Bookcaps Study Guides. www.bookcaps.com. Copyright 2014. All rights reserved. Cover image copyright Stephanie Frey, Fotolia.com. Table of Contents. About LIFECAPS. Chapter 1. Chapter 2. Chapter 3. Chapter 4. Chapter 5. Chapter 6. Epilogue. Bibliography. About LifeCaps. LifeCaps is an imprint of Bookcaps Study Guides. With each book, a lesser-known or sometimes forgotten life is recapped. We publish a wide array of topics, from baseball and music to literature and philosophy, so check our growing catalog regularly, www.bookcaps.com, to see our newest books. Chapter 1. Despite the New York Yankees' storied history of abundant individual greatness and unrivaled team success, the 1972 squad was a pale imitation of the teams that had made the Bronx Bombers the most famous sports franchise in the world. With Babe Ruth and Lou Gehrig long dead, Joe DiMaggio and Mickey Mantle enjoying retirement, and Yogi Berra at the helm of the crosstown New York Mets, manager Ralph Houk's squad tallied 79 wins and 76 losses to finish in fourth place in the American League East, 6.5 games behind the division-winning Detroit Tigers. It was the eighth consecutive year without postseason baseball for the Yankees, after the team had won 15 of the previous 18 American League pennants. This prolonged lack of success had led in turn to a relative lack of interest on the part of the team's usually enthusiastic fan base. Fewer than 1 million spectators passed through the turnstiles at Yankee Stadium that season, the first time that had happened since the end of the Second World War. An average of 12,550 people attended Yankee home games in 1972, considerably below the high of 30,830 set during the team's heyday in 1948. Meanwhile, the Mets drew twice as many fans while winning more games than the Yankees for the third time in 4 years. As could be expected, changes abounded for the Yankees in the offseason, both on the field and off. A pair of late-November trades brought Matty Alou from the Oakland Athletics and Greg Nettles from the Cleveland Indians into the fold. While Alou was in the twilight of his career and would last less than one full season in the Bronx, 1973 kicked off Nettles' 11-year run as the team's regular third baseman. Then, in a press conference at the world-famous 21 Club on January 3, 1973, 42-year-old Cleveland-based businessman George Steinbrenner announced that he and a group of investors had bought the Yankees from the Columbia Broadcasting System for $10 million. And though Steinbrenner promised that day that he would be an absentee owner who would stick to building ships, it wasn't long before the man who would come to be known as the boss put his indelible stamp on the one of the most tumultuous eras in the team's history. But as much as Steinbrenner's acquisition of the team would alter the course of baseball history, it was overshadowed in spring training by the surprise announcement of a transaction involving the team's pitching rotation. On March 5, left-handers Mike Kekich and Fritz Peterson, who had combined to start 64 of the team's 155 games in 1972, met separately with the press to announce the details of a trade they had finalized the previous October. This particular trade had been carried out without the knowledge or consent of general manager Lee McPhail, and did not bring any new players to the team. Kekich and Peterson, friends and teammates since 1969, scandalized the sports world by announcing that each had moved out of his own home and taken up with the other's wife and children. "It wasn't a wife swap," Kekich said at the time. "It was a life swap." Kekich, a hard-throwing 27-year-old who had split his time between the starting rotation and the bullpen during his time with the Yankees, broke the news first that morning. Peterson, a 31-year-old former All-Star and 20-game winner with pinpoint control and a penchant for practical jokes, addressed the assembled Yankees beat writers in the afternoon. Both laid out the same basic story. The two couples had toyed with the idea of exchanging partners through much of the 1972 season, then decided on a 2-month trial swap once the season had ended. In October, Kekich had moved in with Marilyn Peterson and her sons Greg, 5, and Eric, 2, in Mahwah, New Jersey. Fritz Peterson, meanwhile, moved in with Suzanne Kekich and her daughters Kristen, 5, and Reagan, 2, 8 miles away in Franklin Lakes. In December, the men briefly returned to their original families in order to make a final decision, at which point the exchange was made permanent. But by the time Peterson and Kekich went public with the details of their private lives, the trade they had engineered the previous year was already proving to be unbalanced. As with many baseball deals, both sides went into the arrangement thinking they were making a change for the better, only to find out over time that the swap was somewhat one-sided. Fritz Peterson and Suzanne Kekich were still living together with Kekich's 2 daughters that March, and were planning to marry as soon as their respective divorces could be finalized. Mike Kekich and Marilyn Peterson, on the other hand, were not doing nearly as well. After living together for 2 months in the fall and another brief period in the winter, it became obvious that the happiness that seemed to come so readily to Fritz and Suzanne was not present in their attempted coupling. They had been staying together during spring training in another attempt to relight the fire that had brought them together the previous year. But within days after the announcement, Marilyn flew to Rockford, Illinois to stay with her parents. "I would like it to work out with Marilyn and me," said then. "But I'm dubious." While Marilyn sought seclusion in the wake of the public airing of her marital situation, her mother told reporters that her daughter had applied for a divorce from Fritz Peterson, but had no plans to live with Mike Kekich again. "As far as my daughter is concerned, there is no swap," she said. "Marilyn does not want a divorce and her home broken up. She is getting one only because Fritz wants one." Unlike Marilyn Peterson, Suzanne Kekich made herself available to answer reporters' questions in the days after the news broke. The 27-year-old mother of 2 portrayed what had gone on between the 2 couples as an organic change that had grown out of normal human emotions. "We were all attracted to each other and we fell in love," she said. "We didn't do anything sneaky or lecherous." She expressed joy at the love she had found with Fritz Peterson, sadness that the relationship between Mike Kekich and Marilyn Peterson wasn't working out, and amazement at the brightness of the spotlight being focused on her personal life. "It's so preposterous that so much attention is being paid to this," she said. "I don't think it merits that much." News of the unusual arrangement made headlines from coast to coast, as the Peterson for Kekich trade became one of the most talked about events of the spring in both New York baseball circles and the national sports media. The Yankees' public relations department couldn't have been pleased about the timing of the announcement. News of the swap broke the day the club announced it had signed Bobby Mercer to a new $100,000 contract. Newspapers devoted prime space to the private lives of the 2 left-handed pitchers, but word of Mercer's deal was harder to find. Public reactions ranged from bemusement to condemnation, and few, if any, were willing to speak up in support of Peterson and Kekich. The same was not necessarily true in the Yankees clubhouse, where the pair seemed to at least find a moderate level of acceptance. Steinbrenner, who had already broken his promise to stay away, was too preoccupied with mandating haircuts for the shaggier-looking players on the Yankees roster to weigh in on the burgeoning scandal. And manager Ralph Houk, whose office in Fort Lauderdale Stadium had been the site of the press briefings that broke the news, seemed content to smoke his cigar and stifle a smile. "It doesn't bother me other than what effect it might have on their pitching," Houk said. "Their personal lives are their own business." McPhail had learned the details of the arrangement in January and had considered trading one of the pitchers to avoid a potential distraction. After engaging in preliminary talks with a few teams, McPhail ultimately decided against the idea, despite the fact that Peterson himself had suggested that a change of scenery might be appropriate. The front office had no official response to the announcement, although one executive was reported to have quipped that the team should consider calling off Family Day. Fellow starting pitcher Mel Stottlemyre, the ace of the Yankees pitching staff since 1964, who considered the left-handers to be 2 of his closest friends, had known about the swap since an unexpected visit from Kekich and Marilyn Peterson at his home in Seattle during the offseason. Knowing his teammates' propensity for practical jokes, Stottlemyre spent the visit expecting Fritz Peterson and Suzanne Kekich to arrive at any moment and announce that the four had been pulling his leg. But when Mike and Marilyn left...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.